Okay.
What the, what this atmosphere is. Okay. Maybe Tuesday, June 18th, 2019, Board of Commissioners, Transportation Committee come to order. Let's just go around the room and give this particular committee, it's filmed from a transparency perspective. It's important for public to be aware of some of the things that are going on in the community, and specifically within its commission. My name is Kelly Robinson, Vice Chairman. I'm also Chairman of this committee and Commissioner of District 2.
Mark Teal, County Administrator.
Jessica Theriault, Assistant to Mark Teal.
Ruben Tillman, Interim Vice Chair Robin.
Gabriella Castro, Intern to Chairman Jones.
Miguel Valentin, Transportation Director.
Gary Watson, Transit Services Division Director.
Jamal Shepard, Transportation Coordinator.
That's it? Okay.
I'm in the back. I'm gonna have to.
Okay, we have, that's fine. We have a representation from, representative from the collaborative firm, Danielle Crowe. All right, so let's hit it. Miguel, first up, and let's just go.
Yes, sir. Commissioner, approval of the minutes for May 21st meeting would be the first order of business.
Okay. Was that, well, I know it was just because I saw it. Is there any comments or edits to the meeting minutes? And then I'd like to get a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any more discussion? All in favor? Board members say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Pardon.
Next item on the agenda is a report from Transit Services Division.
Okay.
Updates on the marketing plan being carried out by the collaborative.
Okay.
And Gary, if you can introduce.
I'm going to yield the floor to Danielle Crowe from the collaborative firm for the report.
Okay.
Danielle.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I was supposed to yield the floor to Michael Hightower, but I guess since he's not here, currently I will gladly provide an update extemporaneously. Since the last update, well, first of all, let me just get up here. Since the last update that we provided, we've conducted several activities. Several get on the board information sessions were hosted. One at Georgia Highlands Community College, Woody Fight, the Douglas County Senior Services Center, as well as we have one final one scheduled for tomorrow from 4:30 to 6:30, an open house information session type where people can get the schedules, get any questions answered, purchase passes, as well as apply for the discounted fares. Some highlights from some of those sessions. At the Senior Services Center, we had more than 70 participants there. We collected more than 50 ADA or discount certification packets. At each of those, we were to have someone from the staff to provide that one-on-one assistance with people who qualify for that service or who needed that. So that's one of the many things that we were doing. In many instances, we had two events per day. So indefinitely, I probably looked like we did. We had two events twice a week. We also hosted our third lunch and learn, which was our first business lunch and learn. At that, we had attendees from several major employers. One of the largest employers in Douglas County was there, was present, and that was from Silverline. Not only did she receive information there that day, but she did receive follow-up email with all of the information which will be provided to their employees, as well as a follow-up call, and I have scheduled a follow-up visit with her as well. So when we do events like that, we not only want to talk to people and share information, but we want to listen. And I want to thank Vice Chairman for also leading that Q&A period, because even though we tell people, you know, this is a time for questions, you do have to probe. And some of the major takeaways from there was that some people are interested in Sunday service. People need information in multiple languages. So even though we've gotten it translated in Spanish, there was that need for entities to be able to translate that even further. So in our follow-up communication to them, I sent the various links to all the map schedules, as well as fact sheets that could then be translated in whatever languages were needed. because I think at that time she mentioned that there were 26 different languages spoken by their employees. So well beyond what we could quickly do for them, but happy to empower them with the basics tools so that they could customize that in any way needed. Some of the other takeaways were that people knew that because of the third shifts that were there at many of these plants and major employment hubs along that corridor, that the current times that we have posted will suit those third shifts. We also heard that there was a need within the hospitality industry, especially with that need for Sunday service because of checkouts. So it was a very helpful exercise, and as I stated, not only did we follow up via email, but we also did follow-up calls, and I think that there is a further need to do that. Another takeaway from the Business Lunch and Learn was some of the information that was shared by one of our guest speakers, and that was Mr. Scott Haggard from the ATL, in commending Douglas County for launching the first, I guess, fixed route system since the express system in the past 24 years. So what we're seeing is that our neighbors are applauding us for where we're going with this in terms of the connectivity that we're already implementing with our regional partners, as well as the fact that we listen to the input from the citizens in terms of even from vehicle selection, understanding that having more and smaller vehicles would allow us to serve people in different capacities. So those were some of the things that were reiterated by those parties during the Business Lunch and Learn. Other exercises that we participated in to get the word out were community kiosk events. We participated just as a pop-up at the Lithia Springs Library. We went back to that location because we know that they have a very large walking population in terms of their patrons, so we were able to assist people there. And we also did another community kiosk at the Douglasville Wind Down, Wednesday Wind Down. So with that, we don't just stand in a section and wait for people to come to us, or maybe I should say I don't. I get out in the crowd, and so we touched at least 150 people. So, and that's not counting the people who actually came up to our tent, got the brochures, and as well as the acknowledgement from the stage by Councilman Davis. So that was a very great event, and what was really unique about that was seeing the Connect Douglas cutaways, which the drivers are out in training, having it pass right there several times during the Wednesday wind down. So people understand that Connect Douglas, the fixed route bus system, will actually connect them to the places that they want to go, including events. And that's one of the things that we've tried to impart to people, that this is not just for people who are transit dependent. This is not just for people who may have a disability and are no longer able to drive. This is a quality of life issue that's going to enhance it for everyone. So some of those people were happy to learn that it will connect to Cobb. It will connect, and they can ultimately take this into Atlanta or take it to Six Flags at other events. So it's not that they can't drive, but that they have options. And that's what this is. This provides people options. Some of the other activities included some of our pushes through our e-newsletter. So within an hour, over 232 people had opened the e-newsletter, which announced once again the launch. It also announced the final get on the board session and provided links to the schedules and maps. Speaking of schedules, hot off the press. So forgive me if my nose isn't powdered, but that's because I've been running all around town. But that's one of the rewarding experiences about this. It's not just helping to drive the creative process, but actually getting to touch the people. To be able to go back to Woody Fight and deliver the schedules and have the people at the front desk say, they were just asking me again about this morning because they don't want to pay, you know, exorbitant amounts. For people on a fixed income, paying $10 for Uber is a lot. I have photos from the drop-off at Wellstar Hospital. So these have been, as I stated, posted on our Facebook page. Links have been emailed to our partners, so they've received it digitally. But also, these paper copies have been delivered at various locations throughout the county. There's one here, the county courthouse information desk, Wellstar Hospital information desk, Woody Fight, Douglas County Senior Center Service, the Douglas County Tag Office, West Georgia Technical, the DFAX Office, the Douglas County Health Unit, the Douglasville Library. The list goes on. And speaking of the list, in our June, in our July, and in the Chapel Hill News and Views, as well as the Villa Rica News and Views, it's going to look similar to the one that's in the June issue, but it's also going to list that, hey, all of the schedules are online as well as available at these locations. So that way people, no matter how we communicate with them, have access to that information. There were several other pieces that have gone out as well. The direct mail piece, which we provided three design options to Gary and his team in April. I think by May, after the last Transportation Committee meeting, once the information for the launch, which Gary and the Department of Communications is planning, launch ceremony, was finalized, that information was included on the direct mail piece, and that was approved on May 24th. So, you know, we're hearing people saying, I received this, I got this email this morning, I know about this. So I'm even hearing people who have partnered with people who are buddies, and they're saying, we're riding on the 20th. So I think there are a lot of people, there's over 500 people have viewed the Facebook post that announces the Get on the Board information session, because it's being shared by our community partners. And I think that's what's, exciting for me, at least, having been here since last March, to see people excited that this is finally coming to fruition. And so, if I may answer any questions relative to marketing and communication.
No, let the record be noted that Chairman Jones is here and she's in full attendance for the meeting. All right, so to that point, very, very well done. And I know there was a request for a documentation of everything you just said, yes. Quantified. And so duly noted, but I appreciate you saying it for the record, because it is acknowledged that here we are the day before, at least our press release, and 48 hours before the actual launch itself. And it's been a lot of heavy lifting, a lot of work. And I think one of the key things here that really made this work was the public engagement. It's easy for us as government to go in our corner and come out and say, here you go. It's another to have the citizens who put us here be involved, regardless and independent of where they lean. It's important that you listen and that you hear and you give them facts and stuff. And again, without that conduit, meaning clever, I would feel differently. I knew that as a government, that's not our specialty. That's something historically in this county that we just hadn't harnessed that. We hadn't developed that muscle yet to be able to communicate. So you are, and your firm is appreciated for being here. It may go unsaid, but I'll say it for the record. You're appreciated. So I appreciate that. Now, let me ask a couple questions with that said. Regarding the, we're at the Hilton. They did say the 5 a.m. And so I think it's one of the, and Madam Chair, this is, the full committee, Madam Chair, is that, okay, so now that, you know, we're 6 months in, we're launching, there's still that 90-day immediate feedback. And so I'm curious is how do we, where are we capturing, and this is really staff as well, they're giving us feedback. This is just not, okay, I got a voicemail, and I'm going to let it go. This is not just I got an email. Oh, it's just like, no, guys, we got to go to a whole nother level, no different than what we talked about the project schedule. How are we going to capture this feedback and ensure that as we come to decision points in the future and milestones, that we can sort of, let's take our list of stuff that we've gotten, whether it's, like employee, and input boxes in the lunchroom. I mean, what is being recommended on how to capture this? And so at some point, the assignment of, at some point, our our talent that we acquired through consultation, consultative engagement goes away. And I'm curious as staff, how y'all gonna institutionalize this and make sure that we bring this back? Is this Jamal or Gary? I mean, who's actually going to own this feedback and ensure when we get to that point where we're in the next iteration, we can incorporate these things?
Well, pardon the pun, but it will be a collaborative effort. We would anticipate continuing our public outreach in many of the same forms that we've been doing. We will also have a number of onboard surveys where staff and our consultants will actually be riding on the buses with the passengers and getting their feedback. The drivers themselves will be a great source of information for us. And then certainly we anticipate a lot of calls, emails into our office.
Yes.
from patrons who have suggestions or comments, and we'll have a formalized process for collecting all that information.
Yes. I agree, if I may interject. I know that was directed towards staff, but it's an ongoing thing, and it's not one that should be starting, and it's one that's already begun. And that's why we could roll those nuggets up, because after any public input, I always try to see what are the takeaways, the major takeaways. Whenever there's a Q&A going on during our lunch and learns, our team is taking notes and we send those things back to Gary. Same thing with the social media. We're not just posting, or I'm not just posting, I'm engaging the public. And there is a policy or a protocol that we devised and suggested to the Connect Douglas team, in that I don't post anything without approval. All of the postings that I create are sent to Gary. Once he approves it in writing, that's once I post. When there are comments, I send them to him. I may give a recommendation on what's the response based upon the information. Sometimes I have to fact check it with our transit coordinator, but all responses have to be approved. But once the collaborative firm is not part of this process, those processes need to be built in and really owned by that team, because social media is an immediate form of communication. We can't wait months to respond to people. Next, the other thing that I'll add is that internal communication and empowering those frontline employees is critical. We cannot afford, this effort, because it's bigger than all of us, deserves to be handled the right way each time. And to do that, people have to have the information, and we all have to sing the same song. Even if we sing in different keys, we have to sing the same song. And so that's important. So when frontline employees and team members are answering the phone, they need to know, if we have this log in place and we've been asked to keep those comments, to keep them. I'm very big on metrics. It's one thing to track transactions, but until we really extract that information and analyze it, that's when we have true business intelligence. So those are just some things that I would add. And
I thank you. You've highlighted something. While my comment was more directed toward why we're here in committee, while this is a legislative function in which commissioners are assigned to alongside staff to sort of monitor, check, and balance things along the way, we're not here day to day. Daniel brings up a good point, which is, okay, well, when commissioners are not here, what is staff doing on a daily basis, the hourly basis, to aggregate this? So it's not either or, it's both. And so she highlights, back to my point, who's going to aggregate daily all this content, all this information, stuff from Cobb, everything else, but also how will that get to the Board of Commissioners? Because this is something that historically, it's a level of sophistication. Now I know, now again, we have transit in place.
Transitions.
They're in place operationally to a certain extent, but there's still a leadership component. I'm looking to see how is this going to reach us so that when it's time for us to make our decision, 2-3 years from now, how we do that, how we start talking about our transit plan, it's both, and you've highlighted that. So I've got to keep on my agenda. Is there any other questions for us? I got to keep going.
I just have one.
Yes, ma'am.
Question.
Yes.
Transportation Director Gilbert Watson, just, you mentioned a formalized process to collect the data, and I'm excited about upcoming repository of information. What is that, can you just kind of share with us briefly what that process looks like? And it says formalized, will it be someone data, you know, taking paper information and then inputting it in the system, or will it be more like a dashboard? Can you explain?
Well, what we have in mind is that we will have a formal suggestion form, complaint form,
yes,
whatever you want to call it. Our staff, basically, our front office staff will fill that out. We'll put that into a database,
yep,
and then we will have regular meetings involving our consultant to go over those. We're our consultant and plus our third-party provider to go over those comments, suggestions, complaints, to where we can address those. And as Commissioner Robinson, as far as your question about how we'll present this information to the commissioners, we'll do that however y'all prefer. If you want us to submit it to this committee as a report and then pass it on to the full board, we'll do that. We'll do it monthly, quarterly, however you would prefer to get that information, we'll provide it.
And I guess there's two parts. There's transitions, which we are holding up to a contract, right?
Correct.
And there are some reports they committed to that you need to work after at some point. What are the metrics? I mean, what is the ridership? I mean, so there's certain things that's universal, like that needs to get out there. It doesn't need to be a committee thing. You need to figure out where you're going to post this. Is there a website? We're going to get to that. Like, okay, guys, there's light. Now that we're live, how will we make that work? And it should be self-sufficient to a certain extent. I'm not designing it now. I'm just making the point, which, okay, we're finally here. And so where are you going to host this information? How easily accessible is it? So that's the one thing that I'm curious. Make sure that the contract information from transitions is available. Pick four or five key variables like a dashboard. Y'all pick them, call it. But we need this, or how are we doing? How many role models? How is that gas? I don't know. I mean, so how about this? How about, County Administrator, if you'll support this, at our next meeting, I'd like for you to walk us to a committee, walk through one of the reports, and we'll have some live data. Can we go with that? And if not next month, because it's mid-month, our office.
Sure.
That, right. That means we'll have a whole full month. Is that okay?
Yes.
We'll probably have more data to start with, and then it'll get less and less and less, but it'll be an ongoing process from now on, even 2 years from now,
mm-hmm,
6 years from now.
Yeah. And we have to submit a lot of this data to
FDA.
Every month, so we'll have it anyhow.
Yep.
So.
And again, not challenges, more we as commissioners want to get familiar and comfortable with. Again, we've got a third-party operator. You know, we just want to get comfortable with the language and the definitions and the words, so we can all be on the same page in that sense as we talk about how performance really is.
Okay.
Well, anything else? I mean, that was good. I mean, tomorrow's tomorrow. Speaking of such, is she usually? Hey, come on back real quick.
Sure.
So, and I don't, Gary, you both, I don't know to the extent and degree, and I'm not pressing it. Tomorrow we have a press release. A press conference. Can y'all talk about that just briefly and what we can experience in doing this
report? So that wouldn't be.
What the county's communications director, Rick Martin, has established is that we're going to have a media availability at 10 o'clock.
Okay.
I'll be there, Commissioner Robinson, would like for you to be there, Madam Chair, and this will be for any of the media that's there. The Atlanta newspapers, the Atlanta TV stations. This will give them an opportunity to get comments from us before the ceremony actually begins. And then, of course, the ceremony itself begins at 11 a.m. We've got a great list of speakers for tomorrow, and everything is being coordinated through the county's communications and community relations department with absolutely vital support from the collaborative firm. But everything's good to go. We're filling in the last minute details right now, just keeping our fingers crossed that the rain stays away. We do have a plan B if it is raining to move inside.
Okay. and that's what I was going to ask, all right, so just leave it aside.
Okay. And one thing I do want to show you is, as we've said all along, this is a historic occasion for Douglas County, and we want to commemorate that. And so we developed a commemorative plaque that will, once we have a ceremony tomorrow, that this will be located at the Transportation Center.
This is over at the...
We will unveil this plaque during the ceremony tomorrow, and then once we unveil it and the service is over, we'll actually install it at the Transportation Center.
Very good. Wow, this is historic. So you're taking pictures? We have cameras here?
Two different photographers will be there.
Not so much about the media, but just our own capture.
Yes, we do. The collaborative firm is going to have a photographer there. Rick Martin's going to have a photographer there. Plus, DC-23 is filming it.
Okay, so we're good to go in and out. But again, it's not intended to be long, just to make your statements. Your speakers are there to, what's the spirit behind the speakers? Or are they just commemorating the moment, the historical moment?
Pretty much. And
I'm just asking.
Yeah, and it's really all of our key partners. We're very fortunate that the regional director of Federal Transit is going to be there. She's over 16 southern states, plus the U.S. Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico. We're thrilled to have her here. Chris Tomlinson from ATL is going to be here. John Orr from ARC will be here. Chris Pumphrey is speaking. Of course, Madam Chair, Commissioner Robinson is speaking. So I think we've got a great lineup.
And if I may add, Chairman, as much as this is new for Douglas County, it's new for many of these folks as well. It is something that they have been supporting and championing, encouraging for a long while, and nobody has made it to the goal, and here we are.
And that's what we said earlier, that's what was brought out during the business lunch and learn by the ATL representative, Scott Haggard, that no fixed route system had been implemented for the past 24 years. So that was his opening slide, to congratulate Douglas County on this feat. So, but as much as it is historic, and that's just my two cents, I'm more excited about what it does for the present, what it does for everyday people, and how it's going to impact their daily lives. It's going to be transformational.
Yeah, you know, it remains to see what the ridership is going to be. We won't know till we actually start. But if the calls, questions, visits to our facility for information about the service is in the indication, we're going to be well received.
Yeah, and again, when I was growing up living in South Fulton, the only option you had was to walk, right? And the number two pair of Palmetto used to take you down the street, down into Atlanta, right? That was back in 78, 79, right? So now we're bringing up a fixed route system. And now they brought the 88 Camp Creek, 80 myself. But now here we are in Douglas County. We're not just starting with a fixed route. We have four other options that are already in play, meeting the needs of the people. Plus, I won't say necessarily this, whatever they call ride share, so it's a different, there is still demand out there, but I'm not saying necessarily it will be the most popular perhaps, but I think it's going to be the most effective of what I call continuity, just continuous, because the other ones has limitations. So I think to your point, ridership, it's one of those, you want to set the right expectation on what you're looking at, right? Again, there's options that are already out there, I think this is going to be some demand that has not been met. I think it's going to be able to enhance other options that are currently there. It's going to be interesting how this plays out, but I hear some commentary, well, it's like, yeah, but it ain't like having my own car and I can drive, right? I mean, so it has limitations for cost, but I think it's going to meet a need in Douglas County in a way that I'm transformational. I haven't thought of that word, but I think it's going to make a difference. But it's going to make a difference in different people's lives differently. You know, if I think about myself, that like, who would have thought 5 years ago when we thought we did that market study, that 5 years later I could not see. I turn in my jab or I turn like, okay, I gotta walk. I'm pretty productive, pretty like, okay, mobility is everything. It makes a difference. It's like, so I hear you. It's not just about those segments and populations in the market study. It's like, it's everyday people. And it's just not people who you think got a need. Yes, I'm disabled. Yes, okay, I'm not messing with the link, but y'all get the point. If you go down the list, there's people like me, or people who simply choose not to drive. Or just prefer to, and especially if you're up in the Northeast, you know, that's the way of life. Wall Street or not, they jump on the subway. And so it's a mindset shift for me in Douglas. It's like, because if you go out there and you really listen, you know, you still, there's still people who are like, public transportation, it's while the door's open and we're saying go, and you're freer at last, freer, that by pun intended, it's like, okay. I had to get used to this, right? And it's not a panacea atmosphere. Like, so I think the reinforcement of the benefits of this, I think, so I said all that to say, and I'm sort of leaking when I'm going to say it in the morning. I don't know what I'm going to say, but it's coming out. But my question to you is, how do we keep the communication going? Do you think we've done a good job, Gary? And I know we have, but I just need to hear this, that we don't think that it's just like a one-time moment, an event, okay, we're done, we walk away. I know you're getting feedback, but is there a continuing education? Not that it has to be these formal town halls, but I think you got to communicate.
Well, that is an absolutely great point, and I totally agree with you that once we have the ceremony tomorrow and the launch on Thursday, we simply can't quit advertising and promoting the service. This has to be an ongoing process.
Part of what we do.
Yes, part of what we do on a daily basis, absolutely.
And not trying to, I'm sure, add additional work between communication and your staff, their operations, you got like, but I just want to like, make a pin to the committee that let's not forget the need to have, you know.
Continuous.
Yes, mm-hmm. You know, and maybe through the website process that's coming down. I mean, some kind of way we just need to all line it up, and it's more, it doesn't have to be, it just needs to, you know, we've got to launch, and then it'll trickle down over time, and y'all work out. Okay. Can we keep going? Or anything else on this one? All right. Miguel?
Yes, sir. And actually, we covered the next item on the agenda already.
What's
part of this discussion, and that was an update on the lunch and lunch ceremony for tomorrow.
Okay. Perfect.
We've taken care of that. Then the next item would be a transfer agreement or a status update on the transfer agreement with Cobb County.
We do have some good news on that. The formal document has not been signed yet. The Cobb Commission doesn't meet again until June the 25th. But we have a gentleman's verbal agreement with the Cobb Transit Director that they will accept our transfers free until the MOU is signed. And so everything's good to go, business as usual on that.
Signed. Gentleman's verbal agreement. So, okay, we're on the phone. Yeah, we're good. We turn around and then just say, we'll follow up with that gentleman's verbal agreement. Said, I just want to codify our gentleman's verbal agreement that, or do we, what are you saying?
Well, when the official MOU is signed, it will just formalize the verbal agreement that we have in place until then.
All right, so in the meantime, are we just, so say it again, we're going to just loaded or they're going to now honor how it works.
No, it'll be handled just like the transfers will once the MOU becomes official. The individuals who are getting off of our bus will give the Cobb driver one of our transfer cards and they'll hop on at no charge. Mm-hmm. And of course, since for the first 2 weeks, since we're offering free rides, someone getting onto our vehicle really won't have to provide anything. They'll just get on the bus. The driver will note that they're driving so we can record that trip.
Yep.
And that's all that we'll need to do.
Those first, again, first early days, I'm connecting over to the number 30, he's just going to take it as is. So no big deal. And we're expecting that the agreement will be signed anyway next Monday, so we're assuming we're good. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yes.
All right. We'll just monitor that. We'll let it be. Okay, that is good news. Okay, keep it moving.
Just chiming a little bit on the transit solutions. I know we've been practicing our runs and it's been going really well. It seems like it's been very successful. Just have a question about how are we synchronizing with COB so far? I know we've been practicing and we've been able to meet them at the point of, I don't know where the bus, I think it's Epicenter.
Yes,
have we practiced to see if we're meeting at the same time, or I just want to make sure that time is.
Yes, ma'am. And we were given a copy of their schedule, which we thought was going to change, but I was assured by the transit manager that their schedule for Route 30 did not change. So there's probably within any given trip from all of us is going probably about 5 to 10 minutes.
Anyway.
So yes, ma'am.
Okay.
So it won't be exactly their meeting at the same time.
Yeah, just but it's synchronized. They don't have to wait.
Good point. Good point. That's when it's going to, obviously we're going to get tested here. The design, we'll see, and that's the whole point of the feedback. Okay, Miguel. Gary, anything else you want to add?
No, sir. I think that's it. We're just really looking forward to tomorrow and Thursday.
Okay. Yeah. Real quick, so as a staff, and it may be all right. We're testing the buses, Madam Chair, to your point, and connecting over with COB. How do we stand on the bus stops? I didn't see them, but again, I wouldn't see them driving up the street, and so that's neither here nor there. How do we stand on getting our bus stops? Are we complete with that process? Are people ready to onboard, or?
All the signs are installed.
How many stops were there roughly?
About 75.
Yes.
75. Okay, right. And so one of the things that we talked about it was referenced at our at the Hilton was the need sort of that what does the citizens look for by way of when they step out there, right? I know when I'm over in Atlanta, I know how to look at the little bus face and the little orange and blue and yellow, whatever it is. And I know, okay, there's a bar stop, right? And some of them look involved, but you know what that historically stands for. Have we communicated and shown the public what the Douglas Connect sign, the official bus stop? Because, again, a stop is authority, right? That when you see a red stop sign, bus stop, school bus, certain things are authoritative. And so what is the authority of the government that says, okay, if I stand here, this is where my public service will meet me. Can somebody talk to me? Have you communicated?
Well, I can say what I've done, and I'll allow the transit division.
So do we have a picture of it?
So I received a photo of it. There was a rendering made by the sign manufacturer. We weren't involved in that process, but when we were planning to get on the board sessions, which is to teach people how to ride and how to access the system, we thought that it was important to include that information. So we requested a picture, and we had those on display at the Get on the Board information sessions. It's also a scheduled social media post. And so that's what we've done from the marketing perspective. It was not available when these brochures were produced back in February, so otherwise that would have been included.
And that'll be distributed to all of them.
We're
going to
try to pull it up for you.
Yeah,
can show you.
We're in the committee, guys.
It's not on there. It's on the.
Oh, I thought it was in your email.
Nobody has that. I'm going to pull my email up on that thing. I can put it on flash drive and then put it on there.
Okay.
Right.
While we're waiting to do that, please allow me to thank Miguel Valentin and his staff for assisting us in getting those signs installed. We had that planned through a contractor, but thanks to Miguel and his people, we were able to get that process completed much quicker. And we're indebted to him and his people for that.
It's all one team.
Yeah, one team.
Thank you.
One Douglas, one team.
Yes.
Thank you.
That's good, ma'am.
With Madam Chair saying, so thank you.
Yeah.
No, I was just saying, thank him for being gloves. I hope they don't have too many calluses, but we're fine.
Yes.
Really appreciate it.
Thank you, Dylan. I was good with that. Thank you so much. Well, I think it means a lot. Citizens engage and they know definitively where the authority stands. And I think it just, you know, sort of like that last, we're live, right? So I appreciate it. So, okay, thank you. We won't belabor this anymore. What else we got?
Oh, I think they're about to pull up a sample.
Okay.
That works. Yeah. You can take a look at that before we get into the next.
Yes, fine.
That's fine. Yeah.
I think that's the type of file that may not enlarge.
It's a PDF.
That's it?
And in the blank space in the middle,
yep.
we will have the route numbers there of which bus that you can catch.
Yeah. Okay. Is it like fluorescent, or is it like, can you see it at night, or, you know, toward the, how does it?
The number for the actual route and the plate is, in the background, is reflective.
You have the numbers up already.
That number, as Mr. Garrett said, where that space is, that's where we're going to put the individual number. Some of the routes overlap, so you may have route 10 and 20 going in the same direction. Mm-hmm. So you'll see multiple numbers on the sign.
Okay. So then Thursday morning, people wake up, they'll know some kind of way that they've got a communication, at least through social media, to that extent of what to look for. But intuitively, people know the buses are live. They sort of know where they've seen the buses on the street. They're going to migrate out there and stand and look, right? And then eventually, over time, through habit formation, they will we'll get this done.
Yes,
ma'am.
Madam Chair,
you're good?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. All right. Anything else on that?
Not on this. I think we're good on the transit side. We're ready to move on to
this talk transit.
The next item on the agenda is related to the bid results for Maxim Road project. This project will do turn lane improvements and signal improvements at Fortin and Maxim Road, and extend about close to half a mile of Maxim Road.
Yes.
And initially, the project was anticipated to run about, I think it was 2.4 million was the estimate. The bids came in at a little over 2.8 million, so there is a shortfall in the funding of about $411,000 additional dollars that either the county would have to come up with, or if we are successful, I've asked for the Georgia DOT to increase the amount of the federal funding in this contract. Sometimes, if funding is available for the fiscal year, they might be able to do that. The additional funding that they could possibly approve, if it is available, would be up to an additional about $350,000. That would leave the county with an additional $81,104 shortfall to make the project happen. So GDOT is considering this request. We will get, the next step is for them to send us a contract to the county to execute. When we get the contract, that will stipulate the amount of federal funds that they are allocating to the project.
Additional funds or?
Either whether, if no additional funds are possible, it will be the original amount. And the county has got the rest of the exposure.
Yep.
But if the funding has been increased, then it will reflect the total funding amount with the increase.
So how do you engage other agencies? We say ask for additional funds. My question is, do you send a formal letter? Do you use a lobbyist? I mean,
no,
what do you do?
It is administratively. When we receive the bids, they have to be conveyed. When the projects have federal funds, the bids are taken at the local level, mm-hmm. and then they have to be reviewed by both the Georgia DOT and Federal Highway. Mm-hmm. When we package the results of the bid and transfer them to the Georgia DOT, that's when the request is made. So it is an administrative request, but it's through a formal process of them reviewing the bids and then sending a contract back to the county. And the contract is a funding contract, essentially. They commit to providing this level of funding if you award the contract.
So here's my request. I'm trying to get clarity. So we apply for a funding, right? We recognize we may need additional funding. Mm-hmm. All right. So I know you formally submitted something before. So this additional amount, how do you make notice to them that there's a, now that you know what it costs, mm-hmm. how do you make notice to them? Is that through a formal letter?
Yes.
So there's a formal letter that goes back and they'll come back and reconcile with their
yeah. Essentially, the letter right. transmits the results of the bids mm-hmm. and makes their request for additional funds.
It's right, it's part of the process, okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so you didn't have to come before the Board of Commissioners to do that, or is that where we're at?
Well, We will have to come to the before the board to award the contract.
Okay.
So at that time, we will know the amount of the funding that is available. We'll have to determine the source.
But it has to go through GDOT and the feds and then
come back
before we know what to ask for.
That's correct. So let it go. I mean, I'm just trying to follow this. So I learn the process as it goes up. And so not this meeting, not next meeting. For what, 30 days at a minimum out?
About 30 days would be a normal time frame for them to let us know what funding is. So the award, whenever there are federal funds, the county cannot make an award of the contract until that process is completed. Mm-hmm. So we're going through the process. Once they tell us, okay, here's a funding agreement, you're okay to proceed, then I go to the board and say, here's where we are. Now, at that time, if there isn't, let's say that the contract comes back in 2 weeks by some chance, I would like to be able to put it on the earliest agenda that we can, but at this point, I don't know exactly how much federal funding there's going to be. So there's two routes to get us there. Actually three, one is wait till we find out. But another one would be to say, out of the committee, there's a recommendation to allocate the necessary funding to make up the difference between the existing funding level, federal funding, and what the bid is, so that we could move the contract forward. That would be one avenue. The other avenue is to say, perhaps grant administrative concurrence that if the funding allocation is increased and the local funding requirement is limited to no more than an additional $81,000, that then you allow me to go directly to the board without coming back to the committee. And that would save a few weeks potentially.
All right, so Julie knows that certain without encourage the administrative concurrence to just not on this one. This one, this project is an important project. This is something that once again we first when BMGDOT came out, we were on some hotel right there at the corner, I think it's the Holiday Inn, right there at the corner of Maxim and Thornton Road. That's when I first met Lisa Cupid. She came over and interviewed us. I said, like, you know, we got interviewed and stuff. And so that's when that alliance of that Cobb Douglas began. I think that was two terms ago for her. I share that in that since then we've had several accidents that have occurred along that corridor, as well as at least one recent death with youth. We know that is a very, very dangerous intersection, and we've been waiting on this for a while. When this first started, we just didn't have the dollars, and we knew that it was a GDOT issue. In other words, we can't get ahead of this. We'll just work on some other things until we get to this point. This is something that has been, I mean, that road is just as bad. I mean, the Maxim Thornton is like what it would call Highway 5 as well as traffic congestion at a certain period of time. It's just brutal. And this reconfiguration is important. The question becomes, and this is probably a good time to say this, it says, okay, so we've come up short. We recognize we had the same conversation in the SPLOS meeting where things are just going to get expensive down here. Things that were on the list, we're just not going to naturally be able to get to it. It's like setting our own expectations. So as I look at the Capital Transportation Fund, and got a lot of projects, everything is not going to be able to, it's an order of not no, but just not now. It becomes a set of priorities. Some of the GDOT priorities gets driven by whoever's shoulder, right? So I get that's a little bit different than perhaps some of the other projects that we may do as part of normal LMIG and moving stuff around. I get it. But, you know, as we become more formalized in our leadership and our managerial approach to things, it's like, okay, so, we need $400,000, perhaps extra, no more than whatever, but $440,000, whatever the case may be. Do we have any discretionary capital? I mean, y'all know where I'm going. I'm just doing this for the record. But do we have any discretionary?
That would almost wipe out the city. Very close.
But it begins to, we're just having a conversation. I'm sure this is not in sin. That's why I don't want to make it a administrative, because it becomes, okay, well, that puts everything else at risk to a certain extent, right? You're trying to not concentrate on one thing. You're trying to spread it out. You're trying to find a fiscal policy approach that says, okay, I mean, you don't want a big bang and just take everything, but how do I, you know, you can get 25-50% of what's remaining, but not all of it. So then what are my other options?
SPLOS would be the only logical option. Okay.
And so, is that our future? Is it? Okay. So again, y'all put District 2 in an awkward spot. and I have to say that because it says, okay, so we're in SPLOS, transportation, or are you talking economic development? Where are you suggesting future LMIG, or what are we saying?
My suggestion would be economic development. It's one category that has the flexibility to do different types.
There's 2.2, last I checked, there was 2.2 million left in that category.
So that's the economic engine on that road, or road and maximum.
And hopefully it comes back.
Is it?
Yeah. I don't
disagree. It's 81,000.
Yeah, I don't disagree, Madam Chair. And again, economic development was designated for that whole area, you know, and again, the comment that was made yesterday, across the street, the west, again, thank you. for, excuse me, the Hilton across the street was something that was part of economic development, right? If you think about the corridor right there at Thornton Road, down by, obviously, the Mercer, go to Walmart, that's all part of that, right? And so that's why that was an appropriate, you know, sourcing fund for that, to make up that backdrop. But what else is in the docket, though, that's coming down? And didn't you, is it Lee Road, so you got to make up for a difference?
Lee Road on the agenda tonight, that's an item for discussion, too.
Yes, Blackstone, there's two more items after this.
Right, there's a couple more.
What are the costs, though? All right, so you just got to frame it for us, so as we go down this list, how much are we talking?
Well, this, if there is no additional funding from...
Capital transportation.
Well, yeah, but from federal funds, then we would be looking at...
Worst case scenario.
For worst case scenario, an additional allocation of $611,000.
That's for all four of these in here?
No, that's just for the one project, and then...
$611,000 or $411,000?
I'm sorry. The shortfall is an additional $411,000.
$411,000.
So $411,000 for the maximum, got it, uh-huh.
And the supplemental agreement for Lee Road is $152,300 and some dollars.
The supplement for Lee Road is $152,000, uh-huh.
And the Whitestone Culvert could potentially add up another $106,000.
Didn't we spot them $800,000 to get that started? Do you still need more money? I mean, I'm asking because I thought that was...
No, not necessarily that we would need... well, let's see. Do you recall, Mark, whether the allocation was up to $800,000? Mm-hmm. So we may be covered for this out of that.
That was a concession that the Commissioner Volcare made. He came into Mark, you remember that, we're in the executive session, and said, you can tell Ann. I said, no. You get to tell her stuff that we did that, so I'm very clear.
We said up to eight.
Yeah, up to eight.
Whatever that's saying, whatever the number was.
And the bids came in close to them.
You want to tell them the reason while I'm looking this up?
Yeah, the supplemental on Whitestone is a variance in the foundation, apparently. When the design project was bid and the design was made, there was the principal or prime consultant for design, and there was a geotechnical sub for design. Both of those plans were incorporated into the bid. When they turned around after the contract was awarded and went to the vendor of the culvert, they reviewed plan for the footings and said, we think that you need bigger footings for this culvert. And so they've been going back and forth to determine how much bigger and what does that mean. At this point, the vendor thinks that there is not only the additional width of the footing, but additional piles may be required. We have the prime reviewing that, or the prime consultant, and a determination will be made within the next week or so as to whether additional piles are required. So if additional piles are required, we're looking at an exposure of 106.
You remember what the bids came in at? On the Whitestone?
I believe it was 1.3, close to 1.3.
It's $800,000 plus what we already had. It's $1,251,981.
That probably could be what the bid amount is. Yeah, I don't have that figure with me.
Yeah, so.
We'll need to get a little bit more clarity on Whitestone, guys. I thought the 800 was what was $800,000 completed.
Yeah, well, it was.
Well, it was when the bid was received. But since then, this has...
The footings changed.
The footings changed.
So we were given the wrong footing design.
So then, so to my point, back to the need to prioritize, the need to, what is the priority? You can't do it all. Without even, like, gosh, you're not sure you can't get there. It'll go fast. I'm just talking out loud and not making a position. It's like, okay, guys, we're mid-year. I'm looking at these ads, and just looking at poker faces, and I'm sitting here like, okay, all right. And all the, no administrative kit, no, you're not going, no, this street isn't open. And this is like, yeah, I hear you. The question is, what is the priority? And that sort of dictates, and I know all this seems to be shovel ready, but you got limited dollars. And we start moving nickels and dimes down, and I've seen that in the past where we move too much around and you don't fulfill the very thing that finally came online. And I'm
sir, go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, I was talking editorial to y'all way back here.
So here's what. So looks like Miguel, were the bids in February, correct?
Yes.
Did we take the low bidder?
Yes.
So email from you said they ranged from $1,185,998.50 to another number. So if that's the low bid, and 800, we were approved for 800,000. That's $65,982. I believe we had $65,982 left to get us to the 800,000 that we were previously approved for.
Yeah.
This is 106, then we're 36 short, 41 short, 41,000.
Right, so 41,000 for white stone.
That's it?
Yes, sir. All right. So that's what that ask in this moment that we're breaking, is that act 41,000 for the record?
Approximately 41,000.
That's fine. 41,000. All right. Let's go back up to numbers a little bit. That's right. That's fine. We're going to go back up to, just want to confirm what I'm looking at, going back up to Maxim Road, 411 is the disparity or the variance.
Mm-hmm. Worst case scenario.
I understand. That is where we're at right now.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So, 411, $119.
Right. So it would be like, what, 125? No. 100 some odd dollars if in fact it's 20% or 25%?
It's close to, it's 20-something percent, okay. Somewhere between 20
and 20. Okay, all right, that's fine, okay. Keep going, and the next one is, let's just hit it. Blue Road, maximum is 411. Blue Road is how much again?
152.
Yes. Mm-hmm. All right, mark that up. 411, 152, that's 506. Right. Then.
Plus 40. Somewhere there, right?
Mm-hmm.
605.
And that's worst case scenario.
That's worst case scenario.
And then if you go best case scenario, we'll just say 81,000 for
yes,
the...
Yes, if you go best case scenario.
Oh, the maximum would be a lot less. Let's see what we have for you. You don't need last year now. I'm always on wings of optimism. So you can.
275,000. Mm-hmm. So big difference.
Mm-hmm. Those who ride on E. Well, they stop and show up to those who just like, I'm okay. So, no, and I, but again, I'm
a ride on prayer.
Yeah, we're not insensitive, you know, to the need of the county. Mm-hmm. It just simply becomes we're trying to, no pun intended, maximize our dollars, which gets me to my point of leveraging our capital stack. Anywhere we can find a grant, Madam Chair, to leverage our dollars, the offset, it should always be pursued. Just us funding things, just incurring costs when there's always supplemental dollars, because local government cannot carry transportation alone. It has to be leveraged. It's too expensive. That's why you see a push from the federal down, like, well, y'all do this. And they, we're sitting here like, and we're like, okay, and that's why you heard us tell Commissioner McMurray, like, look, we're not broke, but we need some help. We can't do this by ourselves, but we're willing to take a lead. But it's always important that, that the administration acknowledges, Madam Chair, to leverage the taxpayer dollars, that they can't be insensitive to the fact that, okay, if there's some money out there, go ask for it. If you need supplements, don't not. That's what I was asking earlier. Well, what is the process to engage if there's additional money left over from whatever fiscal cycle, or just because everybody else is not ready? Well, if they, some of the counties or the jurisdictions not ready, you can get in there and slip and take that, you know, and again, it's competitive. So we don't want to be complacent in our approach. And again, so as it relates to the priorities of commissions, we're actually advocating for, and Mark, you know this, leverage that capital stack, and it doesn't matter how we get there.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay, so how do y'all, so this is just more of a notice, or?
Well, no, Commissioner, if I may add,
please.
All three of these projects are
on the list.
On the list, two of them to be moved to construction.
Okay.
One of them to get off the shelf to move to construction. So essentially, this would be an investment to get us over the goal line, all three. And as we've discussed, the maximum exposure is more than the CTF can handle right now. But hopefully some of these figures will come back and it will be a more limited exposure. The question then becomes, do you want to wait until you have the exact figure to make a decision, or do you want to strategize through what the funding source ought to be and then be poised to move the item to come before the board, or to get a notice to proceed to the contractor to start construction?
So, you know, as chair of the committee, and knowing the importance of this meeting, Madam Chair, there's no confusion about, you've expressed this, that public safety is important. I'm just going down the list here. Public safety is important. So here we are now. We talked about Baxter Road. We talked about how concerned we are about, oh my goodness. I get it. I'm not challenging the importance of the budget. I'm making sure that we're aware that we got limited dollars. And while we were first starting, and we had this philosophy, it was like, yeah, we're finally getting stuff done. Yes, we're moving. Like, okay, guys, you know this is about going out, right? This round is like, and that's all I'm saying is that, okay, on the back nine, you got to pick and choose. Right now, it's just unlimited, where you just sort of like, well, I'm young, it's okay, I don't have to worry about, it's a finite life. Like, oh, I'm just moving because the money was new. It was like, okay, we're just getting stuff done and so forth. Now I'm looking at it like, okay, the need is still great, but that dollar is shrinking now. That's all I'm trying to, like, okay, guys, it's like, you're still going to, I mean, I get the faith, but it's like, okay, this is math. Like, I want to get to Mars. I don't want to land somewhere between the moon and Mars. I want to get there. Like, okay, well, based on this calculation, it's straight, like, you can't get there on a tank of gas. So I want you guys to be aware that as we're, and I think we've had this conversation before, it's almost like a deja vu moment, which is, I'm okay. I'm willing, Madam Chair, to put down, like, this is the priority. We know that there's going to be some shrinking needs, the capacity to address all the needs are going to shrink, and they're going to shrink fast. That's all I'm saying is that, okay, you're right at that point where, you know how you need the gas tank gets to a certain point and it really drops?
Mm-hmm.
That's all I'm saying. It's like, it's not, I'm not a fatalistic person. I'm very pragmatic, like, okay, look. And it's not, you know, an emotional moment. It's like, okay, guys, just want to be all aware. And all I'm doing now is bringing a certain amount of serenity. Says, okay, I'm good. But you know this. So that there's no disappointment, or that there was expectations and they're out there. Oh, my projects are going to get done. My projects are going to get done. I'm saying, okay, this window's about to close on our capacity to deliver. In other words, we're going to be in trouble ready for the things that we got right now in this immediate moment that's ready to go. But the things that are out there, that's what I was saying yesterday, recently, you got to set the public's expectation. Don't get out there and do this political pontification and just like, no. And again, I'm closer because I'm paying, I'm obviously in this space and I'm seeing it. That's what I'm like, no, I don't necessarily, I don't know if I want to take that one offline, but I'm just saying, if we allocate more, and so I'm going to bring this full circle, all right? That's what we're asking for what, today, if we're asking, I'm just saying for this conversation, it's what, six, do that again?
Yeah, as of today, yes, $605,000.
Okay, so not to exceed appropriation of 605 with the intent that staff will seek grants and keep pursuing it, is that accurate?
Yes.
I'm just restating.
And if I may offer a point of clarity, both the Lever and the White Stone Culver projects already have supplemented
they are
by
maximized, yeah.
Well, they're supplemented by SPLOST funding.
Mm-hmm.
So the decision has been made to support both of those projects with SPLOST dollars. Lee Road, on the other hand, well, Lee Road actually has quite a bit of funding, and maybe that is the difference. I misspoke. The Lee Road and the White Stone Culvert have SPLOST funding. The one that does not is maximum.
The maximum that's listed in the SPLOST list is for those sidewalks.
Right.
Right.
No, it is. Well,
yes, it is.
It's not right, your
put on the
it,
list.
So it is there. For no, it is this project as well, but the additional funding. So actually, all three projects already have a level of funding.
All right. So here's the and again on the list. That's fine. There's no worries around, but whatever shovel ready, we gotta go. We gotta keep it moving. Else, you know, we could lose expiration dates on the grants and stuff. Like we did with Lee Road, you may miss it.
We're not doing that again.
Right. So I'm not forsaking it. I'm just making sure. Now, you've just increased the draw on the remaining funds that we have available. I'm okay with that. Right. So I'm going to go, okay, this balance is not so concentrated in one district. I feel what the decision is, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, okay, District 4, that's fine. I'm just like, okay, it's all balanced. It's not.
Right. These projects are in three different districts.
And so, I'm doing this for the record for consideration that it's equally spread, right? Not by equal dollars, but just the fact that we acknowledge that it's not just so concentrated. But that means that something else gets, it's going to eventually get started getting knocked out. And that's all I'm saying. As much as we're waiting, and again, I can't speak to future SPLOTs, but right now, based on what we got, this is, I mean, if you take the Lee Road, which consumed all the economic development, the LMIG and the SPLOTs, resurfacing, it's just going to play itself out, right? It's just whatever's on the list, and it just becomes whatever it becomes. Like, your hand is already dealt, right? Short of appropriations associated with the annual budget process, but obviously SPLOST is the much bigger carry in our annual budget process. I'm just setting the expectation in this meeting.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying, respectfully. Yes. However, that's all I'm saying.
In the economic development category, with that $2.2 million balance, there are no projects listed down below. So technically, it wouldn't knock anything out. It would just use some of those funds.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, I'm just going to say, I'm going to keep it moving because I'm just going to make a statement. All right, the economic development was originally slated to help fulfill the Thornton Road Master Plan. Option A versus option B. $21 million versus $45 million. We knew that this 10 million was just supposed to get us started to deal with that side access room right away. And again, I got great history here. So, so now how much like we gonna need for that? Just in the immediate projects that are sitting right there on Thornton Road, that you know, get the arterial all the way down to Rock House for the sake of the conversation, right? Just to get out the gate on Miguel, you know what I'm suggesting.
I know what you're suggesting, and
you can frame around that.
Okay. Yes, I can, and I will do exactly that. We are in the process of looking at alternatives. The original vision would have been much more costly. We think we have found a better way to do it, a more cost-effective way, not because necessarily we are that much smarter, or maybe that's not the only. but because of the way things developed in that area. So other solutions have become viable. That being the case, we certainly would do well to look at the remaining funding in that category, and before we commit to anything else, make sure that that element is covered.
I get it. I get your statement. All right, so that being said, so I'm making a note of that, and but the Board of Commissioners has not heard your thoughts, right? The public has heard and at least committed to a master plan with a lot of effort and stuff that they have a certain framing, right? So while I get that we have now, staff has envisioned a new alternative to that, until that's in the atmosphere, that's what I have to keep pushing, like, okay, well, you need to bring that up with me. And again, so in the meantime, it's an immediate audible, you're calling right now, it's like, but I don't think we can admit this right now. But duly noted, until we actually agree to shift this, because what we're saying is that we're going to abandon that, like, no, guys, I'm not forgetting what that master plan, because until y'all get that official record, we get caught out here by shifting away from the master plan with no, like, how did that shift? I that's when I'm like, no, I'm not going to do an administrative concurrence on something like that. It's like, that's too big.
No, and Commissioner, to clarify that,
please.
We will have a more or a much better defined alternative that we will come back with a cost associated with it,
yep,
for consideration. So it's a matter of us continuing the process to define that to the point where we're ready to do that.
Yep.
But the sense that we have based on where we are is that we probably would do well not to commit beyond where we are right now.
Do you hear that?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Mark.
I've talked so much, I'm even a cold. All right, so here's that being said. I'm ready to, Madam Chair, my recommendation that we bring this topic to the full Board of Commissioners with the set of recommendations accordingly.
What is the mark, 605?
Yes, sir, 605.
Broken out, let's have a broader. So
so I did look through, if I might, Commissioner Rollins, I did look back through the list again.
Yep.
So technically that $800,000 from Whitestone came out of the sidewalk and the bridge category. There is $818,000 remaining in that category. So that's after Post Road Bridge right away. The equipment was in there. Whitestone covered $800,000 right away at SR5 and I-20, mm-hmm, which was the left, dual left turns. There's a balance of $818,000.
In that section, in bridges.
No, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Let me keep going. $300,000. It's a balance of $300,000 in that category.
You can't get there with that number.
Well, we could for the Whitestone.
Could for the Whitestone portion, not for everything.
It would come out of a different category.
If Whitestone would be 42, that would say it's a little bit in the economic development category.
Mm-hmm. I can agree with that. Right, so
is that point will come on Whitestone, is, you know, you said we can get the Whitestone to $300,000, but you're still going to push for that grant and you just reimburse that.
Absolutely.
You can reimburse that $300,000. I know you need to go right now, but however, you can continue to pursue the grant and then you just reimburse that account. Is that?
Before we can move forward, we'll have to have.
We will
not. We'll have to have it from the feds and the state.
Right.
Okay. So the difference is that the response would come back midstream between now and our next committee meeting. And depending on the outcome of the discussion today is whether I need to wait to bring it back here or be able to take it to the board directly with a recommendation.
So we'll have the number when we come to the board. We'll know.
I'm fine with this one, which is to say the exact number. 300, what's the maximum?
$605,000.
No, this is Whitestone loan.
Whitestone loan, $42,000.
Right, so I would like to get a recommendation, make a recommendation. I'd like to get a motion to make a recommendation for the Board of Commissioners to approve this amount with the source of the bridge component, right, of the current 2016 SPOS.
So moved.
Second. County Administrator, did you, we need to discuss this. You have a motion and a second?
Yes, sir.
For the amount? Yeah, you need to brief.
Not to exceed an additional $42,000 allocation to the Whitestone Culvert project out of the remaining funds from the bridge category in SPOS.
The 2016 SPOS.
Bridges and sidewalks.
Yes.
That bridges and sidewalks. All right. So, any further discussion? We've got a motion and a second. All agree to vote in committee members, say aye.
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 Any ayes? Okay, one down. So it's 4-1, correct? Who voted no?
Oh, I thought you did.
No.
I gave that one.
I was like, all right. So I told y'all to say aye, but I'm counting myself.
Yeah, you said aye.
All right, yeah. Because I can't see your hands, so you got to say so I can hear voices. Okay, my bad. All right, we'll keep it going. Let's back up to really the original one, which was obviously the Thornton Road Maxim. That's important. That's something that has been holding out there for a while. We knew that we needed to put up additional money for, I mean, obviously we took it out of SPOS to deal with the sidewalk to make it all the way down to the line. We're ready to go to construction, is what I'm hearing you say?
Correct. Now, the sidewalk extension to the county line is not part of this project.
I understand. But we got money that was set aside.
For that, correct.
For that. This has to be finished first, and then that's supposed to come later. All right, I'm just saying it for the record what this is about. Okay. So, again, so can I get a motion on what's being asked for this not to exceed?
I make a motion that we allocate an additional up to, not to exceed an additional $120,
yes,
to the Maxim Road project.
Source
from SPOS,
economic
development category.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Take that amount to not to exceed out of the 2016 economic development subcategory. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
I just have one comment. I was trying to
give I was waiting for somebody to say, yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Just if you could just make a note up also, just add, I know it's 411, but you got a reimbursement point to come back in there with that. So make a note of that, because I believe that's going to happen. Do we want to dismiss that completely? Or?
No, not at all. The motion is up to that amount, and it hinges on what is necessary to get us to the total amount. So if the funding, federal funding comes back and we only need another $81,000, that's all we would take.
It's not to exceed.
Yeah, okay, not to
exceed. But we would know before he would do any of
it. We'd know before the board meeting.
Yeah.
And make sure the board is aware of that.
Certainly, when I present the item, I will go through all these.
Okay.
That was my question. Not right now. Okay. Last one. Lee Road.
All right. Lee Road. That is, again, $152,000 to bring the project. This is for design and environmental work.
Yep.
To bring the project up to current standards and get it ready for construction. We are looking to have the project ready by this time next year.
Yes.
If everything lines up and the funding lines up, we would be able to bid the project for construction next June.
Yep.
And if not, then it would be the following fiscal year. Now, the fiscal year for GDOT starts July 1st.
Right.
So if it's not June, it could be sometime in July or through the end of the year or into the following year. But nonetheless, our goal is to have everything that we need to do ready for next June. So we need several components, one being the funding, again, to re-engage a consultant, and that was $152,000.
And where are we pulling that from?
That would be out of SPLOST. Now, with that, because there is already a SPLOST allocation for construction, and we don't know exactly what the construction bid is going to be, you could sort of defer adding to it for this component and wait to see if you need it when the bids come in.
This is construction for Biden Leroy?
Biden Leroy.
And that's 21 million?
That's correct.
We already knew that, so.
So if the bids come in at 20,
you
will not need an additional 152. You would have, if they come in at 23, then we'll be out of the difference.
What you're saying is we already have 11 million allocated.
You could take this out of it.
We could take it out of that, see what the construction bids come out in next year, and then come back one way or the other, either subtract or add. Which would be the same thing, either way. Just depending on how you want to do it.
New economic development. Don't tinker. I don't like.
Okay.
Tinker. Take it out of economic development. It's the same bucket. Just add 11,120. You know, whatever that is. Don't.
Do we have
we appropriated. We do it too much publicly to get that appropriation. Moving it for Adway. Keep doing this. Like, no, it's frozen. Leave that alone. Mm-hmm. It's solid. Don't. That's what gets us in trouble. We start moving. All right, we have a, can I get a motion?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion that we allocate an additional $152,304.09 out of the 2016 SPLOST Economic Development category to the Lee Road Phase 2 widening project for purposes of the design update of the plans and the environmental document.
Second. Well stated. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion from anybody? No? All right. We got a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed from voting members? None. Motion carries 5-0. All right. Anything else, Piero?
No, sir. That's
okay. I got one topic. I just want to update the comprehensive transportation plan versus the comprehensive transit plan enhancement. I want to clarify the Board of Commissioners' action and what this intent was. 2 meetings ago, the Board of Commissioners agreed to allocate an additional 125 to enhance our current comprehensive transportation plan, as it was acknowledged and publicly discussed that it was not going to have two at the same time because our needs just weren't that great. We're just launching our public service regarding our public transportation service here. It's now upon us. Obviously, we need about a year's time to sort of navigate any learning from that. This process, we were told, would take 12 to 15 months. And so the goal of allocating the 125 was, when the board agreed to do that, the intent was for the staff, director of transportation, to reach out, or whoever you guys, whether you had a lobbyist or so forth, reach out and see if there was any additional money that could leverage our capital staff. Like, we've done all these projects in this conversation, which is like, okay, I want a more enhanced storyline. The Board of Commissioners were expecting that. It wasn't, like, it's not an ask. It's like, well, we know we don't want to spend two of them. And we were told in meeting, and we said it in committee, that we could just beef up this. And I want to clarify what the intent of the board was in that 125, and I'd like to know, right, when was that RFQ originally, before the board took its actions, that it was supposed to be enhanced before it went to the street, with this enhanced speech of transit component? Can I get a status on that?
Yes. After the discussion and the request to, rather than two separate studies, to combine and have an enhanced transit services component, I approached the Atlanta Regional Commission and indicated that that was the desire of the county. They expressed to me that because of the status of transit services within the county, the fact that there is not a lot of existing infrastructure or data to analyze, that they felt pretty confident that we could have an enhanced analysis to what is feasible based on where we are within the original budget allocation of $500,000 in federal funds and $125,000 from the county. And they did not, they indicated they would not be in favor of additional funding, advocating for federal funding or allocating federal funding for this effort, because they feel that it can be achieved within the budget as currently composed.
All right, so to that point, I'm hearing conflicting messages of that. How do we get clarity and confirmation on, can they come out and represent that to us? I'm hearing conflict, which is, well, I heard that there is opportunity, and that it's just opportunity. So how do we get confirmation? I'm okay, I really don't know how we can approach this, but I'm hearing that there is opportunity for us to expand to ensure, because to your point, while we got little, we're aggregating that. The original intent when I met with the ATL, the ARC, and you guys were part of that meeting, because I wanted to get clarity on, okay, so what's really there? How does this process work? And my goal was to think long-term funding. We're starting this system, it's a pilot program with the various funding options. Okay, that may not necessarily meet that's a little too soon. We ain't got enough data. It really should take 12 to 18 months on this. All right, so now, in my mind, I'm talking about 12 to 18 months from now sometime, 2021. So we're buying time, right? So we, by that time, we've aggregated some data, and we want a richer story. Now, I've heard from you that there's, I'm hearing mixed messages. I'm hearing like, they need to be separate tracks. Now we're saying that I need something that's official. Our lobbyist has had conversations that has given me different input on sort of what that is. So, county administrator, how about, can we just have a follow-up with someone from there to explain what this is? Because we were told that we could beat this up. The Board of Commissioners took action. Now we're hearing, different reasons why we didn't want to do it, separate. I'd like to get us all together to sort of clarify this, because it's important. We want the quality of the report to be what we're looking for, which is just be comprehensive as relates to transportation and the transit component. I don't agree, Madam Chair, that we should be two different plans. That's too, why are we doing that? We're not that big. What I'm hearing them say is that it's somewhere in between. Well, what we have is like what the board would like to see, what you have versus perhaps a beefed up version, because again, we were led to believe that it could be beefed up.
I think what Miguel is saying is the ARC believes that we can get that expanded transit plan with the allocation that they're providing for us, correct?
With the current
update.
Right. You haven't explained what that was. The point was to allow you to be able to have a more enhanced, and if you needed it out, we allow up to whatever 120, whatever the money was. The point was, well, But what is that difference? For you to say, listen to the logic, that what we submitted, they're saying you can get there based on what you wrote, but what's the variance then? Like, in other words, if you're telling us you can beef up the RFQ that you've already written that allows us to get additional dollars to maybe enhance this, then what was that beef, what was that beefing up? Because again, what this says that, well, we're not going to do nothing, it's like, this is good, but what was the difference?
Let me explain. There is a base level of analysis. The comprehensive transportation plan has certain minimum requirements. And I'll use numbers just for the sake of the explanation. These are not attributable to our CTP. Yep. But let's say, for example, to use round numbers, that the base analysis that's required by the ARC would cost $400,000. But let's say that is where the proposals come in. They do allow us, in discussions during the funding allocation phase, to say, okay, that's what would be needed for a base analysis. However, we have certain components of the CTP that we want to beef up. We would like additional funding for those components. And depending on what it is, they may allocate additional funds to do that. Well, we did that. We went from the original $312,000 in federal funds, and that got beefed up to $500,000. We have the discretion in carving the RFQ to focus the effort on those additional areas that we want. Mm-hmm. Well, the transit services is our primary additional focus area. So, whereas we could have used that to have a consultant analyze gaps in sidewalk or additional bike lane requirements from park to park to park. Now, they're going to look at all of those components up to the base level. But if we wanted additional emphasis, we could have directed the additional effort to that. In this case, we are saying we're okay with the base analysis for those components. We want you to now focus on transit services. And so therefore, what the ARC is saying to us is, based on the fact that you do not have a lot of existing infrastructure, that is a heavy effort requirement for the typical CTP. They have to look at the existing roads, connectivity, all of those elements, condition. Mm-hmm. For transit, that's not in place. So there isn't a lot of effort that's needed for the analysis of existing. What they would look at is, okay, what is existing and what is projected within the time frame of the analysis based on the prior studies and based on where we are. The ARC believes that we can accomplish that level of enhanced services within the existing book of 625 total.
That's the round number back to the full 500, or what do you say?
Yeah, 500 plus 125. 500 federal, plus
125. Correct. So, and the board commissioner said, well, we're willing to do an additional up to 125 to deal with any variance. So if you had such a concentration in transit out of three additional base, are you, can you now go after those two? We're saying don't compromise on the other areas now, Chair, of the overall transportation that allows you to get to the base. We're saying, okay, your transit is important to us. Yeah. So we're saying, that was the whole point of up to whatever you needed to fill out those areas. This has consumed all of that just to get it up to the place where, okay, you can get there. But you see what I'm saying? But what about those other areas that, go ahead.
Okay, well, and I think part of the discussion initially was, from the ARC was, we believe that you have sufficient funding as is currently formulated to accomplish this. However, if you want additional emphasis on transit, you're welcome to put additional funding into it. They're not suggesting that we limit ourselves to whatever level of analysis we want. They're just saying they're not looking to pay for it.
We'd have to overmatch, in other words.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But come back to, we're at up to 125. Again, this is stuff that we, you know, I was kind of interested in, there's going to be two different plans. It's like, okay, I'm hearing mixed messages on this. Where do we stand on the RFQ itself? We haven't seen this beefed up attempt that you went back with. Like, did you rewrite it? Did you put additional numbers next to it?
No, the RFQ was not written initially. It's a work in progress. No, because we need the funding agreement back from the ARC before we can advertise. So it's being put together.
So while we're in there, the ask was, and again, that was the whole point of it was about resource constraints, having a lobby, so somebody saying, hey, so again, if you haven't submitted the original RFQ, how do they tell us no? If you haven't been trying to get
because we've already engaged in the funding agreement. There were a lot of discussions prior to that as to, they have a formula based on population as to what the allocation is. That had yielded a lower federal funding amount. When we engaged in discussions about enhanced areas that we went to look at, they upped the amount to the 500,000.
Right, so they've already upped to it. I'm hearing, because when I was in the room and talking to them, like, no, there's opportunity. It's not that fixed. It's not that, like, no, there's opportunity to expand if there's a need, right? The consideration could be given. So that's what, yes. I was looking in my eye as a commissioner sitting in that room. So it's not so fixed based on formula and that's all you're going to get. It's like, no, it depends. And so again, so we're sort of dancing around this and I'm just trying to get a little bit more clarity. It says that, okay, but we know that there's a bend to this. And if we, and so can we at least get, how about we do this? Let's just start with, can I get a copy of this current status of the RFQ? Mark, can you sure I get a copy? Just for me, I'm not trying to make it more than that. I just like to read what we currently have and what we submitted. And it just seems like we're struggling amongst ourselves, the internal. They're like, there's too many different messages internally. We're on the same team. On Douglas, we're trying to go and get additional funding. We're trying to let, what is, why is there's, it feels like there's a drag on this.
We haven't submitted the RFQ to the ARC.
We have not.
We have not. Okay. We submitted the funding agreement.
I see.
So it sounds like to me we're all on the same page, we're just telling it in a different version. So if you take, so the initial plan, correct me if I'm wrong, Leo, so mm-hmm. The initial CTP that ARC is expecting us to send them with the RFP or RFQ, mm-hmm. So that goes out on the street. Once we get the RFQs back, and so if it's decided at any point, either now, beforehand, or afterwards, so say it's decided now that we're gonna beef it up and we're gonna do this, and these, RFQs come in at $100,000 more than what the funding level, local and feds, mm-hmm. Then we can take it out of this 125.
Correct.
Yeah.
So it's there, it's just not.
Yeah, see here's, and I listen to you, I'm like, but here's my issue. When staff gives Board of Commissioners advisement, right, I always say, well, we're the five, there's no six commissioner, right? So we take what you guys say, and we make decisions. It can't just be sort of a, okay, let me show you this, but I really mean this. It's like, no, we're committed to this, and we're looking for some intelligence. Right, this is like, I look how we ask, you're consuming this meeting, but it's like, okay, now we're looking for something. And it seems to be a struggle. That bothers me. Because it's like, guys, it ain't that hard. I've talked to the power that's over here at the ARC, right? I've talked to you. I've listened to, you know, you just talk, well, it's going to be two different, like, I mean, two different, like, Now, I let you go in the meeting room, I'm gonna come back to that. We're in public meetings here, and I'm getting different, I'm like, why is this difficult? We're just, and you just say, well, we haven't even completed the RFQ in writing it the first time, and we can beef it up, but then that messes in some kind of way got to the, well, show me the two different versions that you submitted that they could take consideration, because it just sounds like it's a conversation. And it's like, I'm having a problem with that. So what I'd like to do to reconcile this is that we don't have to belabor this meeting. I'm going to call a separate meeting, Madam Chair, with the county administrator. And we can, you know, I'm trying to avoid a court. But nevertheless, no offense, Madam Chair. But I want to get more clarity on where we stand today. Show me the RFQ today, right? Show me what was submitted to the ARC by way of our application, our funding agreement. And show me where you submitted to them a variance of asking for a beefed up, where they came back and said, no, that what you got is sufficient, if you haven't even completed the first one. But you're saying it's based on this funding agreement, so I'd like to see that. Let's just start with that, and we can go from there. Because I'm just, it just seems too much of a struggle. But okay, that's all my ask is. That was the last item on this agenda. Is any more discussion on that?
None on that, but actually there was one item that I missed that I'd like to double back on.
All right, we got a few more minutes. Cool.
Okay, we can do it real quick. On the Lee Road, on the Lee Road widening project, we also have to, between now and probably the fall, engage with the utilities to have to update the agreements, the relocation agreements with the utilities. They had submitted estimates on what it would cost for them to move out of the way probably 4 years ago now, and they have to update that.
Yeah.
One of those agreements, we do not concur with their assertion, and so we're having to re-engage them in discussions. So at some point, we'll be coming back to the board with agreements from at least two different utilities that would have to be in place before the project can be up.
It's just more of a permitting, or is this a cost with this?
There is a cost.
Okay,
because it's they are entitled to be reimbursed under certain circumstances. They are asserting that they are eligible for reimbursement in the entirety of the project. We do not concur with that, so we have to get them to look at the project plans again, give us an estimate, and engage them in an agreement that we can bring back to the board. And that could add cost to the project. It is expected that it would be within the $21 million total. But depending on where we land, it could be less than what they're asking for. And that's what we're trying to do.
When you say less, I'm missing this.
Well, Commissioner,
the $21 million that we've allocated so far, right, and you're saying there may be additional costs associated with them getting out of the way, meaning whatever that means for utility, moving their poles, shifting over. I'm looking at, is there a difference between $21 million we've already given you, and which I'm okay with. I'm just saying, okay, is that another million, another half million? What are you saying that now we got to go through this permitting process? We got to pay for them. What are you saying? I'm curious.
The total exposure, if we were to take their assertion to the campus,
yep,
it's probably in the neighborhood of 1.2.
That's what I was trying to get at.
Okay. We do not concur. We think it's probably half a ton.
Yeah, but still, again, one more time, this is why you came nickel and dime with that money we've set aside, don't you? And this is the part of not having, like, what is the project schedule, laying out the cost to go along with the timelines, and it helps us make better decisions. So y'all come in here and it's sort of just okie dokie against the board, and I'm sitting here like, okay, gosh, it's good thing I can top weight pretty fast, because, like, it's like a shell game, and it's not bad, it's not intentional, it's not right or wrong, but it's just like, it's not the most efficient way to manage. And that's what I'm saying. Okay, I'm trying to lay out all the costs, we're trying to leverage all of our dollars and stuff, and I'm, but again, look at, on one side, there's an ask, the other side, there's a, and it's, well, come on. That's, and that's my challenge, is, and this is where you have to put restraints on, well, you're not gonna be able to do everything. I know that there's a wish list, but I'm setting expectations that says, okay, this is gonna slow down real fast here at this rate. Because all I'm hearing is the ask. I'm not hearing the, we're sensitive to the needs of the taxpayers, and let's try to leverage. Let's hear the commissioners' priorities and their intent and their approach to policy. All I'm hearing is, gimme, as opposed to working with us and representing our voices with those agencies to say, okay, let's help, you know, this board of commissioners fulfill this objective. So that's all, when I hear, when I feel something, it's like, okay, all right, we'll come back to that. But, all right, well, duly noted, I mean, you're just saying just a duly noted, right, until we hear back.
Is that true?
All right. Madam Chair, I'm good. Let it come back. We gotta get it right. County Commissioner, anything else? We're long.
No, sir.
All right, anybody else? All right.
Yeah, I just want to say,
yeah, please.
It's not little to me, it's very significant. I appreciate the, our team and show us our leaders, and also an amazing team for being able to, for number one, for your resilience and your ability to digest constructive criticism. However, but commending and complimenting is vital in order to retain a superior team, to move our county forward. So I just want to let you know that I'm humbled and for this historical and transformational moment that's coming up tomorrow. So I wanted to commend you, Larry. Thank you, Mark Teal, for being a great county administrator, and also thank you, Gary Watson, for leading this effort. And then Jamal, thank you for coming in and bringing some of the ideals from MARTA and all the things that you had in your hat to help move this initiative forward. And thank you to Valentin and Collaborative Firm. Thank you so much, Daniel, for being so patient with us during the marketing process. And Miguel, I just want to let you know that I've been tallying all through Chapel Hill News and News, so it's hit 55,000 houses that we are on the road to recovery, and that's from a transportation perspective. You have 700 road miles that you have to oversee, and thank you so much, because we have a lot going on. I-20 is certainly a representation of what's happening here in Douglas County. The construction is all over the place, so thank you, your entire team. So that's all I want to say. Commissioner, this tomorrow is a big day for us. I'm very sentimental today and emotional, because this is big for Douglas County, so thank you. Huge. Okay. Are you okay?
No, we're going to leave it on that high note. All right, we'll see y'all in the morning. Meeting adjourned.
Yes.
All right.